I sing of warfare and a man at war. From the sea coast of Troy in early days, came to Italy by destiny. To our Lavinian western shore, a fugitive, this captain buffeted cruelly on land as on the sea. By blows from power of the air, behind them baleful Juno in his sleepless rage. And cruel losses were his lot in war, till he could found a city and bring home his gods of Latium, land of the Latin race. The Albine lords and the high walls of Rome tell me the causes now. O muse, how galled in her divine pride, and how sore at heart from her old wound, the queen of gods compelled him, a man apart, devoted to his mission, to undergo so many perilous days and enter on so many trials. Can anger, black as this, prey on the mind of heaven? Trian settlers in this ancient time held Carthage on the far shore of the sea, set against Italy and Tiber's mouth, a rich new town, warlike and trained for war, and Juno, we are told, cared more for Carthage than for any walled city of the earth, more than for Samos even. There her armor and chariot were kept, and fate permitting, Carthage would be the ruler of the world. So she intended, and so nursed that power, but she had heard long since that generations born of Trojan blood would one day overthrow her tyrant walls, and from that blood a race would come in time with ample kingdoms arrogant in war, from Libya's ruined. So the parquet spun in fear of this, and holding in memory the old war she had carried on at Troy for Argos' sake, the origins of that anger, that suffering still rankled deep within her, hidden away the judgment Paris gives, snubbing her loveliness, the race she hated, the honors given, ravished Ganymede, Saturnian Juno, burning for it all, buffeted in the waste of sea, those Trojans left by the Greeks and pitiless Achilles, keeping them afar from Latium. For years they wandered as their destiny drove them on from one sea to the next, so hard and huge a task it was to found the Roman people. They were all under sail in open water with Sicily just out of sight astern, light-hearted as they plowed the white-caped sea with stems of cutting bronze, but never free of her eternal inward wound. The goddess said to herself, give up what I began. Am I defeated? Am I impotent to keep the king of Tyrians from Italy? The fates forbid me. Am I to suppose could Pallas then consume the Achaean fleet with fire and drown the crews because of one man's one mad act, the crime of Ajax, son of Oileus? She hurled out of cloudland lance in fire of Jove, scattered the ships, roughed up the seas with gales, then caught the man, bolt struck, exhaling flames in a whirlwind, and impaled him on a rock. But I, who walk as queen, as queen of all the gods, sister and wife of Jove, I must contend for years against one people who adores the people of Juno after this, or lays an offering with prayer upon her altar. Smoldering, putting these questions to herself, the goddess made her way to storm cloud country, Aeolia, the weather breeding isle. Here in a vast cavern, King Aeolus rules the contending winds and moaning gales as warden of their prison. Round the walls they chafe and bluster underground. The din makes a great mountain murmur overhead. High on a citadel enthroned, scepter in hand, he mollifies their fury, else they might flay the sea and sweep away land masses and deep sky through empty air. In fear of this, Jupiter hid them away in caverns of black night. He set above them granite of high mountains, and a king empowered at command to rein them in or let them go. To this king, Juno made her petition. Aeolus, the father of gods and men, decreed and fixed your power to calm the waves or make them rise and win. The race I hate in crossing the Tuscan sea, transporting Ilium with her household gods, beaten as they are to Italy. Put a fury into your winds and make the long ships thunder. Drive them off through bodies in the sea. I have 14 exquisite nymphs, of whom the loveliest by far, the Poia, shall be your own. I'll join you two in marriage, so she will spend all future years with you as you so well deserve, and make you father of her lovely children, said Aeolus. To settle on what you wish is all you need to do, your majesty. I must perform it. You have given me what realm I have. By your good offices, I rule with Jove's consent, and I recline among the gods at feasts. For you appoint me lord of wind and cloud. Spear half reversed, he gave the hollow mountainside a stroke, and where a portal open, winds in ranks, as though drawn up for battle, hurtled through, to blow across the earth in hurricane, over the sea, tossed up from the seafloor, east wind and south wind, then the wild southwest with squall on squall came scudding down, rolling high combers shoreward. Now one heard the cries of men and screech of ropes in rigging. Suddenly, as the storm cloud whipped away clear sky and daylight from the two Creans' eyes, and gloom of night leaned on the open sea, it thundered from all quarters as it lightened flash on flash through heaven. Every sign portended a quick death for mariners. Aeneas on the instant felt his knee go numb and slack, and stretched both his hands to heaven, groaning out, "Triply lucky, all you men to whom death come before your father's eyes. Below the deck at Troy, bravest Danan. Diomedes, why could I not go down when you had wounded me and lose my life on Ilium's battlefield? Our Hector lies there torn by Achilles' weapon. There Scapidon, our giant fighter, lies, and there the river Simois washes down so many shields and helmets with strong bodies taken under." As he flung out these words, a howling gust from due north took the sail aback and lifted wave tops to heaven. Oars were snapped in two. The prow shared round and left them broadside onto breaking seas. Over her flanks and deck, a mountain of gray water crashed in tons. Men hung on crest to some, a yawning through uncovered button. Boiling waves and sand, the south wind caught three ships and whirled them down on reefs hidden mid-sea, called by Italians the altars, razor backs just underwater. The east wind drove three others from deep water into great shoals and banks, embedding them and ringing them with sand, a desperate sight before Aeneas's eyes. A toppling billow struck the Lycian's ship, Orontes' ship, across the stern, pitching the steersman down and overboard. Three times by eddying sea carried the ship around in the same place until the rapid whirlpool gulped it down. A few men swimming surfaced in the welter, so did shields, plank, precious things of Troy. Ilioneus' good ship, brave Achates' ship, the ship that carried Abas, and the one Aletes sailed in, hale in his great age, were all undone by the wild gale. Their seams parted, parted and let the enemy pour in. During all this, Neptune became aware of hurly-burly and tempest overhead, bringing commotion to the still sea depth and rousing him. He lifted his calm brow above the surface, viewing the great sea, and saw Aeneas' squadron far and wide dispersed over the water, saw the Trojans overwhelm the roaring clouds of heaven, and saw his angry sister hand in all. He called to him eastward and south and said, "Are you so sure your line is privileged? How could you dare to throw heaven and earth into confusion by no will of mine and make such trouble? You will get from me but first to calm the rough sea. After this, you pay a stricter penalty for your sins. Off with you. Give this message to your king. Power over the sea and the cruel trident were never by his destiny but mine. He owns the monstrous rock, your home, east wind. Let Aeneas ruffle in that hall alone, and lord it over winds are shut in their prison." Before the words were out, he quieted the surging water, drove the clouds away, and brought the sunlight back. Cymothe and Triton, side by side, worked to dislodge the grounded ship. Then Neptune, with his trident heaven, heaved them away, opened the miles of shoals, tempered the sea, and in his car departed, gliding over the wave tops on light wheels. When Rhyton breaks out in a great city and the rampaging ramble goes so far that stones fly and incendiary brands, for anger can supply that kind of weapon if it so happens, they look around and see some dedicated public man, a veteran whose record gives him weight. They quiet down, willing to stop and listen. Then he prevailed in speech over their fury by his authority and placates them. Just so, the whole uproar of the great sea fell silent, and the father of it all, scanning horizons under the open sky, swung his steam around and gave free rein in flight to his eager chariot tired out. Aeneas' people made for the nearest land, turning their paws towards Libya. There's a spot where, at the mouth of a long bay, an island makes a harbor, forming a breakwater where every swell divides as it comes in and runs far into curving recesses. There are high cliffs on this side and on that, and twin peaks towering heavenward impend on reaches of still water. Over these, against the forest backdrop, shimmering a dark and shaggy grove cast a deep shade, while in the cliffside opposite, below the overhanging peaks, there is a cave with fresh water and seats in the living rock, the home of nymphs. Here, never an anchor chain, never an anchor biting fluke need hold a tired ship. Aeneas put in her with only 7 ships from his full number, and longing for the firm earth underfoot, the Trojans disembarked to their possession of the desired sand beach. Down they lay to rest their brine-soaked bodies on the shore. Achates promptly struck a spark from flint and caught it in dry leaves. He added tinder round about and waved it for a flame burst. Then they brought out the grain of Ceres, tainted by seawater and Ceres in plants, and weary of their troubles, made all ready to dry and grind with millstone with what they had. Meanwhile, Aeneas climbed out of the peaks for a long seaward view, hoping to sight Gale 1, Antheus, and a Pygian Byrmes. Capes on high poops bearing Caicus arms. He found no ship in sight, but on the shore, 3 wandering stags behind them, whole herds followed, grazing in a long line down the valleys. Planting his feet, he took in hand at the bow and arrows carried by his side, Achates. Then, aiming for the leaders with high head and branching antlers, brought them first to earth. Next, he routed the whole herd, driving them with his shafts through leafy places, shooting and shooting till he won the hunt. By laying 7 carcasses on the ground, a number equal to his ships, then back to port he went and parceled out the game to his ship's companies. Then he divided the wine courtly. Isates had poured out and given them on the Sicilian shore full jugs of it. When they were about to sail, by this and by a simple speech, Aeneas comforted his people. Friends and companions, have we not known hard honors before this? My men, who have endured still greater dangers, God will grant us an end to these as well. You sailed by Scylla's rage, her booming crags. You saw the Cyclops' boulder. Now call back your courage and have done with fear and sorrow some days. Some day, perhaps, remember, and even this will be a pleasure. Through diversities of luck and through so many challenges, we hold our course for Latium, where the fates hold out a settlement and rest for us. Troy's kingdom there shall rise again. Be patient, save yourselves for more auspicious days. So ran the speech, burdened and sick at heart, the faint hope in his look, and inwardly contained his anguish. Now the Trojan crews made ready for their windfall and their fate. They skinned the deer, bared ribs and viscera. Then one lot sliced the flesh and skewed it on spits, all quivering, while others filled the bronze cooking pots and tended the beach fires. All got their strength back from the meal, reclining on the wild grass, gorging on venison and mellowed wine. When hunger had been banished and tables put away, they talked at length in hope and fear about their missing friends. Could one believe that they might be still alive? Or had they suffered their last hour, never again to hear a voice that called them? Aeneas more than any secretly mourned for them all, for that fierce man Orontes, then for Amycus, then for the bitter fate of Lycus, for brave Gaius, brave Cloanthus. It was the day's end when from highest air Jupiter looked down on the broad sea, flecked with wings of sail, and the land masses, coast, the nation of the earth. He stood on heaven's height and turned his gaze toward Libya, and as he took the troubles there to heart, Venus appealed to him, all pale and wan with tears in her shining eyes. My Lord, who rule the lives of men and gods, now and forever, and bring them all to heel with your bright bolt, what in the world could my Aeneas do? What could the Trojans do so to offend you, that after suffering all those that they find the whole world close to them because of Italy? Surely from these the Romans are to come in the course of years, renewing Teucer's line to rule the sea and all the land about it. According to your promise, what new thought has turned them from father? I console myself for Troy's fall, the grim ruin weighing out our fate against another in the scales. But now, when they have borne so many blows, the same misfortune follows them. Great king, what finish to their troubles will you give? After Antenor slipped through the Achaeans, he could explore Illyrian coves and reach